You give me the call. Oh, there it is. How you doing, folks? Praise God. Come on here in the shade. We are on, and so we welcome you to our evening service, our Sunday evening service. I don't think I'm going to need my hat. That's good. How was it? Was it really? Oh, well, then I'll put it back on. Anything to help my brother out? Welcome, and let's just praise the Lord. Well, soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Let me tell you, no more crying there, we are going to see the hallelujah. Soon and there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying, no more dying there, we are going to see the King. Let me tell you, no more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, no more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. We are going to see the, let me tell you, soon and very soon. We are going to see the hallelujah, soon and very soon. We are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Pray for us, Pastor Dave. Danielle, we're ready for you too, if you're ready.
So, Lord, we're just so thankful that you have given us the grace sufficient to be here today, God.
Amen.
We acknowledge that we desperately need you to fill and to breathe life into everything who we are, everything that we bring to you, and everything that we do. So we would just release you by your Spirit, God, to be take your rightful place in this meeting tonight, God, that we might touch you, that we might be touched by you, that we would have eyes to see and ears to hear you, and that as we mutually come together, we would be encouraged, we would be equipped, we would be more available to your promptings of your Spirit, Lord God, in the coming week, and God, that you would be glorified in the earth as you are in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. He's the Savior of my soul, Jesus, my Jesus, he's the Savior of my soul, he's the Savior of my soul.
heaven saw your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you. And nothing compares to the promise I have. None like you. All of my days I want to parade the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you. And nothing compares to the promise I have. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. I love you forever, I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have.
I'll gladly bow my knee
and worship him alone. Lost your way. Oh. follow me if you think that you can. There'll be times when the skies are gray, but I'll be there every step of the way. So follow me if you think you know who I am.
If you think you know where I'm bound,
follow me if you think.
Skies are gray, but
I'll be there every step of the way. So
follow me if you think you know where I'm bound. If you'd like to be free,
follow me if you think you'd like to be free. Follow me if your weary eyes long to see. There'll be times.
Father loves you.
Follow me if you think my Father loves you. Follow me if you think you might love him too.
There'll be times when the skies are gray, but
I'll be there
every step of the way. So follow me if you think my Father loves you. No, I won't leave you behind.
Follow me, you know I won't leave you behind. Follow me with your heart, your soul, and your mind. There'll be times when the skies are gray, but I'll be there every step of the way.
So follow me, you know I won't. Father loves you.
Follow me if you think my Father loves you. Follow me if you think you'd like to be free.
Think you know where I'm bound.
Follow me if you think you know where I'm bound. Follow me if you think.
Moments like these, I sing out a song, I sing out a love song to Jesus. In moments like these, I lift up my hands, I lift up my hands to Jesus.
and my soul shall not be satisfied until I see your face. I long for your return for me, dream of your embrace. Though at times it seems so far away, I know the time is near. You will come and take us.
Father, we pray that you will open our eyes. We want to see Jesus tonight, Lord. We want to see you in your majesty, your beauty, your grace, and your love. And Lord, we will see you, and we will find you in the Word of God. That's the greatest way that you speak to us, Lord. We're so delighted to be in your love. We're so delighted to be in your presence. Now move by your Holy Spirit upon the Word of God. And as Pastor Nick brings the teaching to us, Lord, anoint the Word as he brings it forth and give us wisdom and knowledge, grace, and love as we open the Word tonight. We love you, and we give you all praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. That good? All right. Well, good evening, everyone. Tonight, we're going to be in Genesis chapter 30. We've been making our way through about two chapters a night. I don't know that we'll do that tonight exactly. We've got two long chapters in a row, so we'll just get going and see where we're at. But tonight, Tonight's, especially the opening of chapter 30, the first half of this chapter, I'm going to be pretty straightforward. This is a heavy chapter, I think. This is one of the sadder chapters in the Bible. Because we see what the effects of dysfunction in a family can be. And we see how ugly it can turn. And we see the hurt that it can cause and its effect. And we're gonna start off reading this whole section, well, a good chunk of it at least, before we jump into it. And we're going to actually back up a little into 29, and I'm going to read starting in verse 31, and then we'll read down a little bit, because it really, you know, as Pastor Ray likes to say a lot, the chapter breaks are not inspired in the Bible, and this is one of those that verses 31 through 35 really carry us and are connected into chapter 30. So let's go ahead and start reading there. It says, "When the Lord saw that Leah was unloved, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. So Leah conceived and bore a son, and she called his name Reuben. For she said, 'The Lord has surely looked on my affliction. Now therefore my husband will love me.' She conceived again and bore a son, and said, 'Because the Lord has heard that I am unloved, he has therefore given me this son also.' And she called his name Simeon. And she conceived again and bore a son, and said, 'Now this time my husband will become attached to me, because I have borne him three sons.' Therefore his name was called Levi. And she conceived again and bore a son, and said, 'Now I will praise the Lord.' Therefore she called his name Judah. Then she stopped bearing." And we had left off last time we were teaching on this, just pointing out how the consequences of what Laban had done with Leah and Rachel, and the consequences of Jacob marrying two women. And really, the reason he married two women is because he loved Rachel. Jacob obviously had no qualms with polygamy himself because he did it, but we don't get the sense that if he had married Rachel first, he would have been like, "Well, now I want to marry Leah." This was just, he wanted Rachel and Leah was in the way, so he married two women. And there are consequences to that. And in Leah, the Lord has compassion on her because it tells us clearly she was unloved. And we're told earlier in the chapter 29 that Jacob loved Rachel. And so as she has each of these children, and we're probably looking at least a four or five year time frame having passed in this. You know, we read it in a matter of 30 seconds, but there's a lot of time that goes on. Think about how long 4 or 5 years actually is, and that's at a minimum in this situation. And she gets to the last child, and this is where we left off last Sunday, or a couple Sunday nights ago, where the fourth child, Judah, is the one that she doesn't name after this kind of feud and this desire to be loved by her husband, that she doesn't attribute this one as "the Lord has judged my cause, the Lord is working for me," this or that. This comes down to, "I will just praise the Lord now." And we have hope, and we have some hope like, oh, maybe the Lord has broken through this difficulty with Leah and broken through this stronghold that holds her back in her life. And we're going to find out that that's actually not going to be the case. Because we'll keep reading in 30 here where it says, "Now Rachel saw that she bore Jacob no children. And Rachel envied her sister and said to Jacob, 'Give me children or else I die.' And Jacob's anger was aroused against Rachel. And he said, 'Am I in the place of God, who has withheld from you the fruit of the womb?' So she said, 'Here is my maid Bilhah. Go into her, and she will bear a child on my knees, that I also may have children by her.' Then she gave him Bilhah, her maid, as wife. And Jacob went into her, and Bilhah conceived and bore Jacob a son. Then Rachel said, 'God has judged my case. He has also heard my voice and given me a son.' Therefore she called his name Dan. And Rachel's maid Bilhah conceived again and bore Jacob a second son. Then Rachel said, 'With great wrestlings have I wrestled with my sister, and indeed I have prevailed.' So she called his name Naphtali. And when Leah saw she had stopped bearing, she took Zilpah, her maid, and gave her to Jacob, his wife. And Leah's maid Zilpah bore Jacob a son. Then Leah said, "A troop comes." So she called his name Gad. And Leah's maid Zilpah bore Jacob a second son. And Leah said, "I am happy, for the daughters will call me blessed." So she called his name Asher. We'll pause there for a second. You know, it's when you read this, you almost don't know to laugh or cry or what. I mean, it sounds like something you would put in a silly movie, like some over-exaggerated sitcom. But this is real. This is what happened. You have two sisters from a man like Laban, who is money-grubbing, who desires wealth above all things, has no problem using his daughter's employees. And we maybe shouldn't be surprised to have Leah and Rachel this way, but these are two sisters at war with each other now. This is a war that started with, and Jacob loved Rachel. That shouldn't lead to this, right? That shouldn't be where we end up. But it is where we end up. Rachel, being so desperate to have children, takes the approach many of us can be familiar with, because maybe we've done it ourselves in our troubles and in our desperations of, well, if God hasn't done anything, then I'm going to do something. And she says to him, "Here, take my maidservant." And this is where we talked a little bit about it, for those of you who are here, when we were talking about Hagar and Sarah, what happened. The tradition in this time, when it says, "Bear him a son on her knees," on Rachel's knees, literally meant what this tradition was, that the husband would impregnate the surrogate as she lay on or sit on the wife's knees. So there would be nothing sexual about it. This is just a business matter. This is, we are going to have a child, and this child would be considered by law Rachel's. Now, whether that means in the home it was considered that way, I can't speak to. I don't know how strong that held. But Rachel, Haven has the right to name her. And again, look at these names that are taken. These names that are taken and the meanings, because Rachel says, "God has judged my case and he has heard my voice and given me a son." A second one, "With great wrestlings I have wrestled my sister." And Leah, who we think had just gotten to this point where she's past it, is no longer past it, because now Rachel's having kids. And what we see is, again, in her heart, it was, well, as long as Rachel's down, and as long as I've got the leg up on Rachel, I'm okay with whatever, and I can be at peace. But the minute Rachel starts having children, right, well, we'll say Rachel having children, as soon as that happens, now Leah's discontent again, and it can't be this way, because Jacob still loves Rachel more. And now she's going to gain, and every advantage Leah had is now going to be taken away. So Leah, not having children anymore, says, "Here, dude, take my maid." And these things, a troop comes. "Daughters will call me blessed." It is sad where these two girls have ended up. And it's not going to be much better as we read on. You see, the other thing we deal with this, before we move on, I want to touch on verses 1 and 2. Rachel, in her desperation, says to Jacob, "Give me children or else I die." And Jacob gives that angry response. He gets angry at her and goes, "Am I in the place of God? Can I give you children when God has withheld this from you?" Husbands, if you're ever in a situation where your wife is not able to bear children, do not say this. It doesn't go over well. Reminding Rachel, God has taken it away from you. In other words, God is punishing you, would be how she hears it, whether Jacob meant it that way or not. Rachel, and Jacob, he's got to be, I mean, he did not get what he bargained for. And whatever Jacob has done in the past, he's certainly getting a full dose back. Again, remember what we said. This started with Jacob loved Rachel. This started out as sees the girl of his dreams. I do think it's interesting, and I don't know that we can read too much into it, but the Bible never actually tells us that Rachel loved Jacob. We make an assumption like this was a match made in heaven. They're so happy to be together, but the Bible actually never tells us how Rachel felt about Jacob. We have another case in reverse of this in the book of 1 Samuel with Michal and David. It says it starts with Michal loved David. It tells us that twice. It never actually says David loved her. In fact, he's kind of pulling the, hey, I'm not sure I want to be the king's son-in-law thing. So clearly he wasn't infatuated with her or anything. And ironically enough, even that relationship ends very badly, doesn't it? Two of the relationships, marriages in the Bible that we're told started with at least one of the spouses loving the other, and it becomes a mess. Becomes a big mess. And we're going to get back to that in a second, but I want to read this last section of this part before we address it. It says, now Reuben went in the days of the wheat harvest and found mandrakes in the field and brought them to his mother Leah. Then Rachel said to Leah, please give me some of your son's mandrakes. But she said to her, is it a small matter that you have taken away my husband? Would you take away my son's mandrakes also? And Rachel said, therefore he will lie with you tonight for your son's mandrakes. And when Jacob came out of the field in the evening, Leah went out to meet him and said, you must come into me, for I have surely hired you with my son's mandrakes. And he lay with her that night, and God listened to Leah, and she conceived and bore Jacob a fifth son. And Leah said, God has given me my wages, because I have given my maid to my husband. So she called his name Issachar. Notice, she is, if you read between the lines there, she is acknowledging that that was not an ideal thing to do. It cost her something to do that, because she's getting her wages back from God. I did something hard, something I didn't want to do, and now I'm getting a reward for it. And Leah conceived again and bore Jacob a sixth son. And Leah said, God has endowed me with a good endowment. Now my husband will dwell with me, because I have borne him six sons. So she called his name Zebulun, and afterward she bore a daughter and called him Dinah. Then God remembered Rachel, and God listened to her and opened her womb. And she conceived and bore a son and said, God has taken away my reproach. So she called his name Joseph and said, the Lord shall add to me another son. You know, clearly they are not over the situation. Clearly the situation has eaten at them. The whole thing with the mandrakes is, in their culture, it was believed mandrakes had fertility properties to them. That if you used the mandrakes in various different ways, medicinally and such, it would allow you to conceive. And look at this. I mean, if Rachel was going to look to have a compassionate sister in her trouble, that clearly wasn't happening. She asked for the mandrakes. Clearly, Leah would have known why she wanted the mandrakes. And notice, let me point this out too, neither Leah or Rachel gained any satisfaction out of their own ways to try and get more sons. Getting their handmaids to bear sons for them didn't work. Yeah, they bore sons, but you can see here clearly it was not a good solution. And clearly we saw the same thing with Hagar and Ishmael. The problem that we run into is when there is a, this is why Solomon would say there, I think he says there are three things, even four, for which are never satisfied in Proverbs. And one of them, he says, is the barren womb. There is such desperation in those situations. The thought that if I could only have this, I'd be satisfied. If I could only have this, my reproach would be taken away. If I could only have this, I'd find happiness and peace and joy. You see, we make a mistake as humans all the time. We often believe the causes of our sorrow are what keep us from joy. They're what keep us from peace. And if we could only get rid of them, that somehow we would have these things. If I could only get out of my chronic pain, if I could only have children, if this relationship could only be restored, if I could only get out of my debt, then I would be happy. Then I would be peaceful. And the problem with that thinking is that none of those things can actually give peace, and none of those things can actually give joy. See, all of these things, all of them, they're a result of a broken and fallen world. What robs us of our peace? What robs us of our joy? It is that brokenness. It is that sinfulness. It is that fallen world that we live in. And there is only one answer to that. And God gave us that answer. He gave us his son, Jesus, to allow us to enter in to that relationship with him, to once again become his sons and daughters. That gives us peace. See, even if we could permanently take away one of those things we think would make us happy, or take away one of those things we think keeping us from happiness. If you went out and won a $500 million lotto tomorrow and you've been in financial trouble your whole life, guess what's going to happen a few days later? Well, you won't be in financial trouble again, hopefully. You could have that money, you could do wisely with it, and never have to think about money again. And guess what? You're still not going to have peace. And you're still not going to have joy. And you're still not going to have fulfillment, because that's not what gives it. God has given us the gift of his Son, the gift of salvation, the gift of peace, the gift of joy, the gift of his Holy Spirit indwelling us. And it isn't related to any of those things. You don't have to be rich enough, out of debt, healthy enough, holy enough. You don't have to be any of those things to come to him and receive. A few weeks ago, we talked about it at a prayer meeting. That's why he would say in those three chapters in Isaiah, he's talking to the barren and the foreigners and the eunuchs and those who hunger and those who thirst. Those are too poor to buy bread, and saying, come to me. I will give you all these things freely. I will bless you. Because that's what he desires of us. And so we have to be very careful not to fall into that kind of desperation, because all we're going to find is emptiness, and we're going to find ourselves farther down that road, which leads us farther away from God. Leah. You know, it's funny. You actually can see Rachel's complete desperation to have children when Leah can say to her, is it not enough that you have stolen my husband? Think about that. The sister that replaced Rachel on Rachel's wedding night, the bride that Jacob worked 7 years for, has the nerve to actually say, you stole my husband from me. And yet Rachel doesn't bat an eye at that statement. She just desperately wants those mandrakes. That's how broken, in essence, you can see Rachel's become. That's how hard Leah has become. So the question that we wrestle with here is, what do we do with this? What do we do with this? People who have gotten themselves in such awful situation, people that are mixing their sin and their consequences and God and his blessings and rewards all together, thinking, you know, Leah, this might be one of the sadder parts of it all. Leah thinking somehow that she earned God's love and compassion on her. She didn't. There's almost no greater slavery and bondage to be in than to be someone who is a believer in God who still thinks they have to earn it. They know the truth of who God is. They know they should love him. They know they should be good. They know they should be all these different things. But they haven't yet understood that they are loved because they're loved by him. And they have not gotten to the point where that's enough yet for them. See, I can't help but feel if Leah could have made that jump, that look at God's grace on me. Look how much God loves me. Maybe she would not have needed Jacob's love so badly. And that's not to say it's wrong for a wife to want her husband's love. It's not. It's not at all. But what do we do in a world where that doesn't happen all the time? What do we do in a world that has accounts like here in the Bible and plenty of stories out there of people that their story started with Jacob loved Rachel and McCall loved David, and they end like this? If these people had lived, how long do you think these marriages would have lasted between Rachel and Jacob and Leah and Jacob in today's day and age if divorce was as readily prevalent as it was today? So what do we do with it? What do you do when there's just a raw deal? Well, we remember what God has promised us. That's where we go. It's no different than the question that many like to ask. Well, if God was so good, why is there so much evil? Why are there so many bad things that happen in this world? How do you answer that question? Well, there's lots of answers to it. It kind of depends how someone's asking it. But that honest heart, that especially that hurting heart that has been victimized by the sin in this world, what do you say to them? Well, for us, when we face it, I think the important thing for us to remember is, one, this is a sinful world. This is a fallen world. This is a broken world. As hard as it is to say this, as difficult as it is, because I think as much as we can mock things like Disney theology, like just follow your heart, it will all be okay, make a wish on a star and everything's going to work out, your fairy godmother will save you, and we like happy endings, we all know the world doesn't give those very often. And we know even when we think they're happy endings, when the prince and the princess get married, they've got 40, 50 years of marriage to go, and it's not all going to be honeymoon phase. We know that very well. And we have to be honest with ourselves on that. And so maybe what we struggle with more, especially as believers, is not really the question, why do bad things happen? I think even unbelievers know that answer in the depths of their heart. What they want to know is either, why has God allowed it to happen to me? Or why doesn't God fix it? Why doesn't God just fix it? I know he can. I know Rachel had to know he could give her a child if he wanted. We all know in financial trouble, if God wanted, a check could show up out of nowhere in the mail tomorrow. We all know it's possible. The old question, the old saying, I know God can, but I'm not sure he will. But there is one thing we can be sure of. You're right, we can't be sure how God will fix our problems. We can't be sure God is ever going to fix all our problems. In fact, if God did fix all our problems, we'd go create a dozen more tomorrow anyway. We will always have, just as we would always have the poor with us, we will always have our problems with us. So what has God promised that we can count on? Well, he has promised that one day, as Pastor Scott, I think, was talking about in Sunday school this morning, all of this sinful and broken world will melt away. And he's going to create a new heaven and a new earth. And he is going to turn to all of us and show it to us and say, behold, I make all things new. All that was there, all that was painful, all that was broken, all that hurt you, all the hurt you did to people will pass away. It's gone. It is no more. And he will wipe away every tear. That we can be sure of, beyond a shadow of a doubt, because God keeps his promises. It will come to no surprise to many of you when I say, I find there's a C.S. Lewis quote that captures this beautifully. That's right, he's not here. It's from the book, The Magician's Nephew. And it's when Aslan looks at the character Diggory and says to him, as Diggory has tears pouring down his eyes because he's desperate to have his mother healed, and he was tempted to do something wrong to try and take a shortcut to it. And Aslan says to him, grief is great. Only you and I know that yet in this world. Let us be good to one another. I think that captures it well. What can we do in the face of that? What can we do in the face of we are all broken, we have all been sinned against, and we have all sinned against other people? We've all done, if we are honest, terrible things to people. We watch cycles in this world. Talk to counselors and you watch people who have been victims of abuse are the most likely population to go on and abuse other people. The statistics bear it out. We live in that world, and so what can we do? We can love one another, and we can be good to one another. And we can be kind to one another because we know what we're going through. You know, all of us have things that we need to be healed of. Physical, mental, emotional. We all have it. And I think our hope and our prayer is, my fear is, I don't want to say fear, let me say, what I hope is that the day that I find I am healed of all, which of course finally will be the day we're home with the Lord, that I don't turn around and see a mess that I left with others. Because God, when Jesus walked this earth and he said things like, love your enemies, be kind to one another, forgive one another, all those things which are extremely difficult to do, he did not put an asterisk next to it and say, unless you're going through this and this and this. That's hard. It's hard to remember that because we get caught up in our own sorrows and our own griefs and our own hurts. But could you imagine how far would it have gone if Rachel had said to Leah, I'm sorry Dad did this to us. Pretty rotten, isn't it? And Leah had said to Rachel, I'm sorry you haven't had any kids yet. That's got to be hard. How much healing could have happened? And they really meant it. And instead of competing and vying and hating one another and wrestling with one another, they cared for one another. So, as I was reading through this, I told you this is a heavy part in a very sad section of Scripture. I think that's what I walk away with this is, Lord, when I'm struggling, help me still to be kind to people. Help me still to love other people. I don't know about you, but I find in my own experience when I can do that, that is often the very means by which God heals me. The very means by which I see his love and I feel his peace and I feel his joy enter into my heart. And so, moving on from there, in verse 25 it says, and it came to pass when Rachel had borne Joseph that Jacob said to Laban, send me away that I may go to my own place and to my country. Give me my wives and my children for whom I have served you, and let me go. For you know my service which I have done for you, And Laban said to him, "Please stay, if I have found favor in your eyes, for I have learned by experience that the Lord has blessed me for your sake." And then he said, "Name me your wages, and I will give it." So Jacob said to him, "You know how I have served you and how your livestock has been with me. For what you have had before I came was little, and it has increased to a great amount. The Lord has blessed you since my coming. And now when I shall also provide for my own house. And now when shall I also provide for my own house?" So Laban said, "What shall I give you?" And Jacob said, "You shall not give me anything. If you will do this thing for me, I will again feed and keep your flocks. Let me pass through all your flocks today, removing from there all the speckled and spotted sheep, and all the brown ones among the lambs, and the spotted and speckled among the goats, and these will be my wages. So my righteousness will answer for me in time to come, when the subject of my wages comes before you. Every one that is not speckled and spotted among the goats and brown among the lambs will be considered stolen if it is with me." And Laban said, "Oh, that it was according to your word." I mean, Laban, he's such a swindler. You just read this and you feel like he is the stereotypical used car salesman in movies, right? Just that guy who flatters, and that guy who, he says all the right things up front, but behind him is the dagger, behind his back is the dagger to stab you in the back as soon as you turn. This is Laban. And I love Jacob's response here, because it actually reminds me very much of what Abraham says to the king of Sodom. And he goes, "Well, what shall I give you?" "Nothing. I'm not taking a cent from you." See, Jacob has learned who he's dealing with here. He knows. And Laban understands the situation too, because Laban cannot argue. We are at the end of the 14 years here, 7 years originally that ended up being for Leah, what was supposed to be for Rachel, and now another 7 years for Rachel. This time is up. Those were his wages for which he worked. That was the agreement. And so now he says, Jacob comes and says, "I've earned this all. It's mine now. Let me go." But Jacob has more money. Laban has money to make here. Laban has more blessing to gain here out of Jacob. So he can't be done with him. "Jacob, what can I give you? Come on, just tell me. What do you want? What are the wages you want?" "You can't give me anything. You're not giving me anything." Because he knows what's going to happen. He knows, just like Abraham said to the king of Sodom, "I will not have it said you have made me rich." Because he knows how that's going to go. Don't we all know somebody like that? That maybe you take something from them, a gift, a time or two, and you realize, "I will never take another thing from them again. Ever. Because the price tag that comes with it." And so, all of a sudden, an idea comes to Jacob. "Here's what I'm going to do with you." And clearly, this must have been the minority of Laban's flocks at the time. He says, "I'm going to take the spotted ones. Give me the spotted goats and the spotted the sheep and the lambs. I'll just take the brown ones. Not much, not many." And Laban's like, "Sure. Deal's a deal. You got it. Those will be yours." But Jacob's clear, and he says, "It's going to be. We're going to do it this way. So you can say, you cannot say to me, 'I stole anything from you. I took anything from you.'" Because at this point, he doesn't trust Laban as far as he can throw him. He is just simply, "You're going to rip me off in some way or another. I know you are. So here's what it's going to be. Nobody's going to question, because the only thing that's going to be in my flock is either the speckled ones or the brown ones." And so, the speckled and spotted or the brown ones. And so he did it. He removed that day the male goats that were speckled and spotted, all the female goats that were speckled and spotted, every one that had some white in it, and all the brown ones among the lambs, and gave them into the hands of his sons. Then he put 3 days' journey between himself and Jacob fed the rest of Laban's flocks. Now Jacob took for himself rods of green poplar, and of almond and chestnut trees, and peeled white strips in them, and exposed the white which was in the rods. And the rods which he had peeled he set before the flocks in gutters, in the watering troughs where the flocks came to drink, so that they should conceive when they came to drink. So the flocks conceived before the rods, and the flocks brought forth streaked and speckled and spotted. And Jacob separated the lambs and made the flocks face towards the streaked, and all the brown in the flock of Laban, but he did put his own flocks by themselves, and did not put them with Laban's flocks. And it came to pass, when the stronger livestock conceived, that Jacob put rods before the eyes of the livestock in the gutters, that they might conceive among the rods. But when the flocks were feeble, he did not put them in. So the feebler were Laban's, and the stronger were Jacob's. Thus the man became exceedingly prosperous, and had large flocks, female and male servants, and camels and donkeys. Oh, Jacob can play this game too. He's shrewd. He didn't lie this time. He didn't cheat. He didn't steal. He made the bargain, and Laban had no idea what he was agreeing to. We have a couple things going on here. We have, first of all, brilliant shepherding by Jacob. Jacob understands this, and it's funny that this is long before anyone knew anything about genetics, as far as we know, and recessive traits and dominant traits. But Jacob got it right. And he said, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take all my flocks and we're going to treat them a certain way. It's amazing how much of this chapter has to do with fertility and conceiving. This is a whole chapter about it. And in his flocks, he does this thing. And I have no idea if there's science behind it. I have no idea if this was a superstitious thing. I have no idea if it really worked, or if it was just God's blessing or what. Or if God maybe gave him knowledge to do this. But he did this thing with the wood in the troughs. Ideally, you would think that's putting some sort of chemical into the waters, and his flocks just start conceiving like crazy. And they conceive, and they're good, and they're strong. But he used it sparingly, apparently, so he did not do this for Laban's flocks. Unless, I think the idea here is, they were weak. So he made it, he shepherded in such a way that all the strong offspring and all the strong flocks became his, and all of Laban's became weak. And you're like, wow, Jacob, that's very legal. You're not lying to anybody. You're not technically ripping anybody off. If Laban doesn't want to take the time to shepherd on his own, this is what's going to happen. But boy, it is a tricky way to get rich. And he got rich off of Laban. And it goes right in, and Jacob heard the words of Laban's sons, saying, Jacob has taken away all that was our father's, and from what was our father's he has acquired his wealth. And Jacob saw the countenance of Laban, and indeed it was not favorable toward him as before. Listen, these are not people you want to work for. Those that love you when you make them money, and those that can't stand you when you don't. Not a great situation. And Jacob picks up on this awfully quick. So the Lord said to Jacob, return to the land of your fathers and to your family, and I will be with you. So Jacob sent and called Rachel and Leah to the field, to his flock. And he said to them, see, I see your father's countenance, that it is not favorable towards me as before, but the God of my father has been with me. And you know that I, with all my might, served your father. Yet your father has deceived me and changed my wages 10 times, but God did not allow him to hurt me. And if he said, thus the speckled shall be your wages, then all the flock bore speckled. And if he said, thus the streaked shall be your wages, then all the flocks bore streaked. So God has taken away the livestock of your father and given them to me. And it happened at the time when the flocks conceived that I lifted my eyes and saw in a dream, and behold, the rams which leaped upon the flocks were streaked, speckled, and gray spotted. Then the angel of God spoke to me in a dream, saying, Jacob,
And I said, "Here I am." And he said, "Lift your eyes now and see. All the rams which leap on the flocks are streaked, speckled, and gray-spotted. For I have seen all that Laban is doing to you. I am the God of Bethel, where you anointed the pillar and where you made a vow to me. Now arise, get out of this land, and return to the land of your family." Then Rachel and Leah answered and said to him, "Is there still any portion or inheritance for us in our father's house? Are we not considered strangers by him? For he has sold us and completely consumed our money. For all these riches which God has taken from our father are really ours and our children's. Now then, whatever God has said to you, do it." And Jacob rose and set his sons and his wives on camels. And he carried away all his livestock and all his possessions which he had gained, and his acquired livestock which he had gained in Padan Aram, to go to his father Isaac in the land of Canaan. All right. So, we do find a little answer here, that this is God's blessing, which no doubt it was going to be. And he ends up having an angel appear to him and say, "All right, time to go." And that's good confirmation, because Jacob's sitting there noticing, thinking it might be time to go because of how Laban's acting towards me now, how his sons are acting towards me now. And then God shows up and says, it's time to go. And so when you notice it looks like it's time to go and God says it's time to go, well, guess what? It's time to go. And we really need to make sure we always listen. And a little in that second half there, we find out how God told him it was time to go. That it was time to go home. But what I find actually fascinating that I really want to touch on here is what Rachel and Leah say to him. It says, "Is there still any portion or inheritance for us in our father's house? Are we not considered strangers by us, him? For he has sold us and also completely consumed our money." That is a very interesting comment. And then they go on, of course, "For all these riches which God has taken from our father are really ours and our children's. Now then, whatever God has said to you, do it." What we see in their hearts is, one, they understand how their fathers treated them. And that's an important thing, I think, one, for us as parents to understand. Our children will largely understand how we treat them. Maybe not perfectly. Maybe they choose to dwell on wrong things. But they understood in the end. You know, I think this is a two-way street in some ways. So for kids, it's important to understand your parents aren't perfect. Your parents are going to make mistakes. Your parents have a sin nature just as much as you have a sin nature. And it's going to come out from time to time. And it is going to manifest in the way they raise you. And yet, nonetheless, God says, honor your parents. That we honor them as our parents for raising us, for caring for us, for teaching us, even if they do it imperfectly. But we can also have the other end of it where parents will often think, well, they know I love them because... the classic for generations in America, dads, well, because I put food on a table and a roof over my head, that's how I show I love them. Well, no. That's how you show you don't neglect them completely. But that's not how kids know you love them. If your primary interaction with your children is largely disciplinary, that's not going to give the best vibe overall of a loving, close relationship. I sometimes think as parents, it's easy for us to not stop and be honest with ourselves and to really assess ourselves and say, what is the primary vibe I'm giving off to my kids? Are the majority of my words along the lines of loving and encouraging, or do I find 80% of the time I'm yelling at them, even if they deserve it, even if we have to discipline them in those cases? But sometimes we, I think as parents, we need to make sure we go out of our way, especially if we have kids who are difficult, kids who don't want to obey. If we have to discipline a lot, then we better find ways to go out of our way to have a positive interaction with them as well. So it's not all discipline all the time. And sometimes that means when we want to sit down and do nothing, we have to get up and do something. And sometimes that means when we just want some quiet time, we've got to take some not quiet time with them. Because who we are, we cannot escape that our children will see it. They're going to see it. Now, Laban, as far as the Bible shows us, doesn't have very many redeeming qualities. Certainly not as a parent. And so we see in him his children looking at him and saying, Dad ripped us off too. Dad sold us. And that's an interesting comment to give to your husband, who was the one he essentially sold them to. And he says, he ate up our inheritance, he ate up all of our money. And so in their mind, everything of this has been justified because he ripped us off, God's ripping him off, is their idea. And it fits perfectly within their mindset with the kids, right? Their mindset of, well, God gave me a son to justify me in this. God gave me a son, so now it will be reward me for this and that and this. When you think about, this is the root of God's chosen people. This is their heritage. I mean, let's just face it here. How many of you, if you had the opportunity, would say, hey, you know what? I'd love my kids to go spend some time with Jacob, Rachel, and Leah to learn about a godly lifestyle. To learn about the goodness of God and his grace. No, you would, if they were your family, they'd be the ones you're like, how can we avoid having to go over there? I don't want my kids staying over there. I don't want my kids learning that stuff. And yet, look what God does. That goes with the reminder of what we were saying. We can get so frustrated with other people. It is so easy to see the faults and flaws in other people. And the truth is, and this is the kicker with it, we're usually not wrong. Everyone else can see those faults and flaws with them too. And I'm sure every one of you could sit there, have a meeting, and pick out a nice list of all of the things I do wrong. And I'm sure I could come up with a list twice as long that you don't even know about. And I'm sure if I looked in the mirror and honestly assessed myself, I'd have to agree to all of them. And yet, though that could be done with every one of us, it doesn't mean a thing for what God's going to do with us. We think it should, don't we? We really think it should. You know, sometimes we hold these ideals and these standards and we take the lists like in the New Testament about what an elder should look like and what a deacon should look like. And we think of these things as, look, if you're holy enough and if you're good enough, you can achieve this. Like it's some sort of game that like, oh, if you're an elder, you're level 20 in the game. And well, this new believer is just level 2 and they've got to level up a bit before they're up to snuff and before God's really going to use them. No, that's not the case. Of course, God has qualifications for certain jobs. Of course he does. That's just how things work on this earth. And these are the means by which he set them up. But these don't speak to our value in God's eyes. They don't speak to his willingness to use us. You know, the bottom line is, just like when God set up creation, and again, Pastor Scott talked about this morning, he set up natural means by which things are done. Right? We have a water cycle that brings rain and evaporates. That doesn't need God to press the go button every time it's supposed to happen. He made it so it happens. God isn't sitting there watching all of our hearts beat because if he happens to miss one monitor or miss one dial, our hearts will stop. He set our hearts up to beat. And yes, he holds our life and our time, but there are natural means by which things work. And even in his church, he has set up to some extent these means by which administration happens. But we've got to be careful not to think somehow because the pastor, the elder qualification, who's qualified as an elder, is somehow holier, somehow if, again, you guys have heard me say this before, drives me nuts. Drives me absolutely crazy when I hear things like on a radio station where they'll be like, we have a prayer line with trained pastors here to pray for you. Like, what does that matter? Like, what, because somebody's a pastor, their prayer counts more with God? Oh, but it makes us feel better. Pastor so-and-so came. Oh, I'm in the hospital. I really don't want just an elder or deacon to come. I need at least the assistant pastor. Right? Don't we do this, though? We forget that God uses his people as they are. He sanctifies his people. He teaches them. He molds them. He shapes them. And sometimes he uses us in that process with other people. And yes, he uses other people in that process with us. And so we should be humble enough to allow other people speak into our lives. We should be humble enough to speak in a lowly fashion, in a humble fashion, into other people's lives when God asks us to. And we should always do it in that position, like Galatians tells us, where we don't go in thinking we're something. Where we don't go in and we don't say, you know, Garrett, I've been watching you. You need to be more like me in this. Let me tell you how I've become good at this. Right? It's the most ridiculous thing. We laugh now, but how many times that is actually our mindset? Usually not when we're directly talking to that person. It's usually when we're talking to our friend or wife or spouse about that person, right? That's really where it comes out. That's what our mindset is. But I just wanted, and we're going to close with this here. We're never going to make it through the whole chapter. We'll finish it next week. But I want to close with that thought. This ties in to what we ended kind of chapter 30 with. So how do we do this with one another? Well, we'd be loving to one another, and we'd be kind to one another, and we understand we never, ever approach somebody when we have to have correction in their lives in a matter that's not only haughty, but never in anger, never in annoyance. It's out of love. Just like his parents, I'm sure Nate and Karen can attest, right? Every key to discipline you ever read, because you're doing the parenting study, they always say never discipline in anger, right? That's always the key. Never discipline in anger. Well, that's the same thing with each other. Don't get mad at one another. How different would it be when a brother or sister sins against us, and instead of being angry at the wrong against us, our heart was broken for the fact that they have sinned? And that they are not right with God in this area. That would change everything, wouldn't it? It's hard. Hard to be there. It's hard to get to the point where we care that little about ourselves. But boy, what would it do for us? So let's pray. Lord, you know where we are. You know where you've left us. You have not yet called us home to this new creation yet. That you have asked us to stay here, to be ambassadors, to bear the good news to this lost and broken world. Lord, we've been subject to the things of this world, to the sin of this world, to the hurts of this world. But so were you. And Lord, you loved and you forgave And you were compassionate, slow to anger. Help us to be like you. Help us to behave in such a way that people look at us and say, you are different. Help us, Lord, to bear our light into this dark world. And perhaps maybe even, Lord, start bearing that light in our own homes, where it can be so easy to fail in these areas. Forgive us where we have. Help us to forgive each other where we failed in these things. In Jesus' name, amen.